wet, miserable, cold, rainy, post-Thanksgiving Day, for the first time, a continuance, a postponement of the East-West High School Football Turkey Day Classic. But your two turkeys, Frank Case and Marvin Walenzik, will be here with guest turkey Pat Carey. And we're going to bring you all of the action today as the first-ranked Central Bucks West Bucks prepare to defend their state title ambitions, their Bucksmont title championship assured. And this team, which has all year come out of the block strong, seldom been challenged, and when challenged has responded like a caged cat, this team has, for the good of this whole area, been regarded and well regarded as a team of superb tacticians, individuals who rely not so much on nuances, but on precision, coaching, and speed. It is a team which has picked the other team's weaknesses and picked it well, and that's a salute to Coach Mike Patton and each member of his coaching staff, a viable, cohesive, contributing organization. And all of it today will be on the line for that brilliant Buck organization from top to bottom, almost mechanical in their performance this year. They will face a team that is better than its record indicates, that started the year brilliantly, that ate up in a Chamonix team that challenged the Bucks in a scrimmage, that is, in the scrimmage, ate up in the Chamonix. A CB East team that has beaten Satterton, that has a very good defense, and if that defense can find the magic formula to interdict the Buck attack, if they can come off and stop the flow, the questionable offense today, and that's the question, the East offense, that will be a big factor. What the effect of the postponement will be? Well, let's get down to Norm Stanley, who's down on the field, and let him show you what it's like close up, and then we'll come back in a moment.
Frank and Marv, it's, as you can see this morning, it's very, very wet down here. I took an opportunity before the game to walk the field, and it's just like mush. I don't know who this game is going to favor. You would think because of the wetness, it would favor the passing game and you'd have to go to West. However, it's very cold down here, and that's going to make the hands cold. The receiver's going to have cold hands. It's going to be hard to catch that ball. This track out here is going to be hard to get a footing on, so it's going to be awfully difficult, and I predict we're going to have a low-scoring game because of that, and I think that it's going to be a pretty even game. But even though it's cold and wet down here, the fans are ready for it, and in watching the two teams before the game, they're both ready for this game. As cold as it is, as wet as it is, I think we're still going to have a good game. So I'm going to turn it back over to you, Frank and Marv, and hope we have a good one here today.
Norm, keep your feet dry down there, but your mud boots are the order of the day. And Frank, one of the big questions is, you see the captains, Jeff Japshin and Teddy Dennis of East, and Bill Kilkenny and Timmy Donovan of West, and the seniors in the center of the field, and the classic Thanksgiving Day ritual, which has become so much a part of the great tradition of this game. Traditions such as fans from both sides sitting in the stands and rooting for their own teams, a neighborhood situation. But Frank, what about the postponement? Because the team that has been the veteran of postponements is East.
That's right. Well, that's an interesting question, and one that will be answered as the game goes on. The thing you have to realize is there's three teams on the field today. There's CB West, there's CB East that beat Reading 41-0, and there's CB East that lost to Perk Yuman Valley. And it depends which CB East team shows up, whether or not they're going to have a chance. If they show up with a team that won nine games, you see enthusiasm down there. It looks like they're pretty excited about today. If they have that team, they can win this game. If they show up flat, maybe because of the postponement, then they're going to be in trouble, Marv.
And Frank, at this moment, the national anthem.
Thank you.
Well, whether or not, Frank, as the flag flies in the distance, you can see there's not a lot of wind, but there's tremendous amounts of rain and wet. And we want to salute the Delaware Valley College for letting these two teams play this game on this field today, Frank. The risk and the circumstance to the field, the contribution to the community by Dr. Joshua Feldstein and athletic director and head coach Al Wilson. I'm probably going to make a senior agronomy project to repair this one. And Frank, we'll take a break. John Duffy, a clean white jersey, number 75, the boy adventurer, the legend, in his own mind, prepares to kick it off for the Bucks. Deep for the Patriots is Bart Sparango, and the whistle sounds, and this one is underway. And Duffy's kick is high, not too deep, comes to the left side, and it's taken in there by Timmy Patterson. And Patterson forks his way across the 30 and up to about the 32-yard line, Frank. And that gives the Patriots some decent field position as Clark Paulus, number 14, heads into the huddle to start this one off. And you see the big forward wall, 60 is Fingleton, 75, the big tackle, Cott, 93. Co-captain Jepson over the ball to find center Coverdale, who's been an unsung guy all year. And we're ready, Frank. Deep back Sparango. They motion.
That's an unbalanced line, Marv.
Toss to Sparango, behind the block of Cott, but he can't get footing. Frank, Cott had an excellent block out there.
That's right. Jeff had a good block, but it was deceiving because he was trying to block Dick Beck. Dick Beck was able to play it down the line of scrimmage and create a pile. As you saw, the running back had to make a move before he got to the line of scrimmage and enabled the other guy to make the tackle.
And in this wet field, Frank, making cuts is not easy. I noticed they had Jeff Bernhardt, number 41, in the lineup, and now they're unbalanced this way, Frank, as they're coming out. Wall and Bernhardt in the backfield. Give it off to Wall. And the running back of way, he's finding a nice hole, Frank, and he hammers across the 35, and we'll give him the 37-yard line and a pickup on that play of, let's call it, five. Excellent block by Cott. Once again, as the big guy, when he comes to play, can play, Frank.
Well, he could be a big determining factor in this game because, as you said, he can be a good player. And on this field right here is tailor-made to a person like him, and we'll see if that holds true for the rest of the game with a balanced set, Marvin.
Fingleton and Gatto with the guards. Clark Paulus back to throw. First pass of the day. Has a man. It is over his head and over the head of Timmy Donovan, who was covering. He was looking for Fahey on a straight-up route, Frank.
That was an odd kind of pattern right there. There were two receivers in the same lane, and I don't know if it was a broken play or what, but apparently they got too close together on their routes. Sometimes with a muddy field, they'll shorten their routes up.
I think also, Frank, I remember they were looking for one of those receivers to break to the sideline because Donovan was sandwiched.
Right.
And only their presence. And back to boot it is Teddy Frisch. The big tight end. And back, of course, will be Tim Donovan, returner extraordinaire for West. The first kick of the day as West is held. No pressure on. Kick is away. It's a bounding kick coming to Donovan. Slow in the mud. Donovan picks it up. Starts to go to the opposite side of the field. And he is hit and brought down, Frank, almost in his tracks. And the guy who makes the tackle is Robbie Cronin, number 22 of the Patriots. And on this wet field, it's tough to maneuver.
He should have just let that ball go. If you're going to let the ball bounce on a day like today, you just got to let it go and not look for any heroics. However, you should never let the ball bounce when you're fielding a punt. With the exception of it inside the 10-yard line, you're going to lose yardage every time, Marv.
East defense, Ejaption and Ted Dennis at the ends. Middle guard is Dortone. Tackles are Knorr and Schult. Steve Clark calls the signals on the rollout. Clark has some running room, and he is hit and dropped, and Frankie gets a couple as the East team filled quickly when Clark decided to keep it himself. And making the hit is Brian Price, number 5, the fine senior, who has been absent with injuries and makes a big difference in this East defense.
He really put a shot on Clark that time. It was a design play, 18 quarterback sweep, I believe, with what a normal terminology would call it. And instead of being a sprint out pass, it's definitely a sweep by the quarterback.
Kilkenny comes on the wing. Donovan, the lone set in the backfield behind Stevie Clark, who's behind Big Radig in the center. Now they shift a power eye, Frank. Draw to Donovan. He tries to break it, and they're all over him. As the charge is led, Japsen read it. Coming from the backside was Schilt. And Frank, on a wet day like this, the footing is going to affect the execution, but the defensive capacity of the defensive lineman to shed blocks and move out is going to be an advantage.
Well, I think in order to try and take advantage of the wet field, Mike Pettine has thrown a new formation. And as East came out unbalanced, West came out with the formation. The guards, extremely wide split, a fullback and a halfback in those holes. Maybe you'll see it again, and you can understand what we mean.
Got Bill Clark on an end, Frank, on a third down and about five. They shift Baggett to the deep back. Back goes Clark, draw again, running the football out of the open, running down the sideline, on his way, it's Donovan, and he's finally dragged down by Brian Price as he crossed the 40 and gets to the 38 of East, and they came draw again, Frank, and they sandwiched the linebacker, got caught inside.
Well, it was a, as you said, it was a draw play right there, and he got an extra block in the backfield, was able to sprint down the sideline. Mike Radigan is a center for CB West, and at the guards, we're going to have Caparo and Chris Groves. Or Dick Beck is in there also, and the one defensive or the offensive lineman for CB is number 64, Ken Button.
Ball rests at the 39-yard line, first and 10 West. Early in the first quarter, they have a big play from Donovan. They give it off this time to number 34, the big fullback, and he hammers ahead. That's Kilkenny,
and brought down.
And my mic
breaks. Your mic does not work.
My mic just slipped, Frank, but it's back again. It's the foot gain of just a yard for Kilkenny as he ran the power off the right side. And Frank, if tendencies show this year, the Bucks each time that they have run that play have come back with either draw or toss to the opposite or wide side. They've come with the big play on the next play. Let's see how that works now. Second and nine. 7:55 to play in a scoreless first quarter. West and East in the classic. Toss to Donovan, has running room, and then he is hit and brought down as he comes across the 35-yard line, Frank, and gets to about the 33. The man on the tackle is Cronin, the corner coming up to make the fill.
Also the transfer, Mark Gatto on the tackle.
Gatto has played very good football all year long for the Patriots and has been a very welcome addition. Let's see what the Bucks have now. They got a third, and we'll call it a long three.
You watch Dick Beck. I bet where Dick goes, so will the ball.
Let's see.
He's playing right guard.
Toss to Donovan. Sweeping. Oh. He is met, and down he goes. As Frank, they read that one. They're not concerned about any fake action. And Eric Knorr, the big tackle on the left side, shed his block and came right outside and made a head-on stick. And if Knorr, as you remember 2 years ago, Frank, with the fine play of Greg LaGreca, so many times penetrated and made hits in the backfield, and that created problems. And the guy who's been filling and coming from the corner all day long is Cronin. And we have a timeout here with 6:54 to play, no score in the football game, and Mike Pettine's coming out on a fourth and very important, Frank.
Right, this will be an interesting down right here because it's almost too long to run for it, so you might have to throw the ball if you're going to go for it in this situation. Now, I think here comes a punting team. I think that if West does choose to throw the ball, I think they're going to do it earlier. Obviously, the later the game gets, the sloppier the conditions. And you can really surprise some teams by throwing the ball early on a day like this when they expect you to run all day long.
Frank, there's a question of what Mike may try to do. He may send the punting team on and have them stay there and just line up and wait and see if he jumps offside, because that's just about enough to get them a first down.
Right.
He may put in the field goal team, Frank. There's no to do the same thing, perhaps.
Marv, I think what you said right there is a real good coach's point, and that's probably the smartest thing for him to do right now, because, as you said, he doesn't have much to lose, and if I don't think he can kick a field goal from this distance. So we'll see what Walt Wandell, the punter, has his troops doing.
He's better get the people off the field, because there's a question. If you got 12 men on the field, that'll do it. They just don't want to go off sides right now, Frank. The punt will be booted from about the 50-yard line, Frank. I'll say the 48. He'll kick from the 45. Nobody's offside. The kick is away. It's a nice kick. And it is taken on the fly dangerously, Frank, deep in East territory at the 10-yard line. And the guy who came up to make that dangerous take was Rob Lockery.
I got
to
give Rob. You have to credit Rob with a wise play on that, because it's in the borderline there. It's on the 10-yard line, but it's a real soft kick. If you let it bounce, it's going to stop inside the 5. He cut the losses and took it at the 10, so it's better than at the 2.
It's a weight of the risk, Frank. The ball's field is wet, and the bouncing will be less. Let's see what happens now. East out of their huddle. Paulus with split backs, Wall and Sparango. Rowell and Bernhard rather give it to Bernhard, and a big fullback hammers off the left side and gets himself, we'll credit him with four, Frank. It'll be second and six. Football rests at the 14-yard line. And the East offense, Frank, right now has been very basic, and they're coming with good power. They're sending a lead back up, but they're also realizing that West has to keep an eye on Chris Wall, and I think where Wall goes, they're a little pursuing over much as Nick Angel comes in at a defensive tackle on that side. Give it off to Wall. Wall has a little bit of running room and gets across the 15. Let's give him the 16-yard line.
Dick Beck brought him down at the 16.
With good help from Radigan, Frank. Beck already looks like a gigantic mud ball down there, which shows you the level of action, Frank. Dick is in on it all. Mike Fahey comes into the football game across the way for East. Number 44. East with a third and we'll call it four at the 16-yard line. And thus far, Frank, since the opening kickoff, because of Donovan's run, which changed the field position in the game, East has been boxed deep. Shift to the eye. Sparango deep. Wall up. Bernhard in motion your way. Toss to Wall. Bernhard delivers the block to Sparango, rather. He has the first down, Frank. Excellent block by Jeff Bernhard as he kicked the corner right out of there.
Yep, that was exactly it right there. That's what made that play go. He got a good block from the pulling guard, but Bernhard knocked down the corner and made it easy for him to get the first.
That's East's first down of the football game, Frank, as West got off early on the fine run by Donovan and put them in a hole. Now the football's at the 21. First and 10 for the Patriots. No score. First quarter, 5 minutes to play. Counter to Sparango. He sheds a block, a tackle rather, but he goes down, and filling for West was 53, and that's Mike Caparo. And if Caparo doesn't come across and analyze that play, Sparango had running room.
They had to block again on the corner, and Caparo made a nice play, obviously.
Frank, so far the field conditions have not been brutal, and the rain has stopped.
But you can already see where it's deteriorating. When we first walked in, the whole field was green. Now this end of the field where they've been playing is awfully muddy already.
Paulus to Wall, breaks a tackle, and then he's met by a whole host of Bucks, led by Kilkenny on the charge. Does not get the first down, comes across the 25. We'll give him the 25.
Matt Baggett, I believe, made the initial hit, and Kilkenny cleaned him up, or dirtied him up.
Be a third down, Frank, coming for the Bucks. Looking at the Patriot offense on third down, we're going to call it five, a long five. Coverdale over the football. Backfield is Bernhard. Jeff Cott is in the backfield for East. They come power this way. Cott delivers a block, but he slipped as he came across. They had Cott lined up like the refrigerator in the backfield. Something we talked about, Frank.
You got to like that. Although it is fourth down, it's the kind of play that keeps your team loose, regardless of whether or not it works, and I think that's the attitude that East has. They come here with not a whole lot to lose except one game. West could lose a lot more than that. And here is where you got to be fearful is John Calvin. Donovan can make this thing happen for him, and with his change of possessions here.
Moreover, Frank, they have a punt block coming from the right side, and Frisch is very close to the line of scrimmage. Snap is high, but he finds an opening and gets it away, and it's not a bad kick. There's not a lot of pursuit, but the ball's not moving.
That's right.
And that'll die at the 48-yard line of East, so that's about as good as they could get out of it.
I think that this change of possessions right here is if you could score that, West is winning the ball game in that regard because they have so much a shorter distance to go to the goal line. I think that's really crucial in a game like this.
Well, we haven't had a fumble in this football game, Frank, and that's a credit to both the execution and the play of these kids. The other thing, Frank, I thought on that play where Cott lined up in the backfield, both Cott and Bernhard went for the inside man.
Right.
One of them takes the outside man.
That's
that may be correct, and
then
the play may work. Let's see what we got here for the Bucks as they swing it out behind Clark. Donovan and Kilkenny in the backfield. Clark on the quarterback draw, and he broke one tackle, but he has dropped in there by Timmy Patterson, who came up the field, but not until he gets four big yards and moves the football to the 45-yard line of East. That's more, Frank. You give him a full five.
That's one thing about Clark. He likes to go airborne. I don't know. That might hurt him in the long run, but it sure is exciting to watch.
Foot changes coming in from the sideline as Drew Wolf, 87, comes into the football game, and you'll see him interchanging here with Billy Clark, number 22. Now full house backfield. Let's see if they shift. They don't. Kilkenny straight ahead, and he is dropped by Schilt as he hammers forward for about three.
He crawled right up Caparo and Radigan's back for a third down and two situation, Marv.
Bob Dortone, the middle guard of East, did a pretty good job jamming there. The ends for East are Japshin and Teddy Dennis.
Mm-hmm.
The tackles are Knorr and Schilt. The middle guard, Dortone. The backers are Gatto and number 42 for East, who is Tommy Dennis.
I think the longer or the better game Dortone has, the more they're going to be in it. I think that's a really crucial matchup for him, Dortone and Radigan.
Big third down play at the 41-yard line. They give it off to Kilkenny, and the big fullback hammers, and he's in close, Frank. That's very close.
That's going to be depend on the spot. There's a lot of bodies piled up right there.
It looks like he has it from this angle, Frank, but once again, that'll depend a great deal on the men down below.
We'd like to remind you...
We're going to measure, Frank.
Marv, we'd like to remind them that today's game is made possible by the support of the Central Bucks Business Sports Team. It's their advertising dollars, which allows you to watch local sports on Home-Vue. Please let these businesses know that you appreciate their efforts.
Frank, not only their efforts, but their continued support year after year after year. And the chains are being stretched, Frank. And I think he's got it by the nose of the football. He does. Bill Kilkenny off the left side has gotten the first down for the Bucks, and they will be at the 39-yard line, first and 10, 1:41 to play in the first quarter of a scoreless football game in which the Patriots have found themselves as a result of a great move by Donovan Early with shifted field position. And the team that can put two first downs together may have a big drive. The wind
That's right.
Whipped up, Frank.
We have yet to see a pass.
Baggett is deep behind Kilkenny and Donovan. Pass by West yet. East has one. Give it back to Donovan. Countering. Gets a great block, Frank. Out in the open. Donovan running. Slips a tackle. May go. He is gone. Tim Donovan will score for West. Timmy Donovan scores for West, as he got a crunching block on the left side by Dick Beck. Dick Beck delivered the critical block as he crushed the linebacker on the left side, and Donovan Frank went 39 yards, finally following the measurement for the touchdown, and the Bucks are up on top, 6-0 in the first quarter, and anytime you're up on top on a day like today, that's big.
That's right, and that's another thing is this is a very crucial point because 1 point on a muddy day like this can make a big difference, Mark.
Well, you know who's back there, the man with the magic shoe. Sean Duffy. He's worked that shoe, Frank. He's patenting it. But the thing is the leg, which has to kick the ball. East fainting as though they're going to come across. Ball is snapped. The ball is fumbled, Frank. It'll be a fire call. Churning
Nobody
to the
throw
corner
to.
Is Nolan. He's trying to run it in. He's not going to get it. Number 22. Now, wait, I said Nolan, but it was Billy Clark. As the point, this ball was on a wet day, was snapped. And the holder couldn't handle the football, Frank. On a cold day, Clark took off for the corner, but nobody ran for the end zone. The play on that, I believe we've seen it before. The end drifts off. He hears the call fire, meaning something's in trouble on the snap, and he goes into that end zone.
Well, as you said right there, they had a block coming on, and when they have a block, you have to spend that much more time blocking them. And that's what happened. The end got tied up trying to block his man and wasn't able to get out into the pattern on a fire call.
The big thing right now, Frank, is the test of the mettle of the Patriots, who got caught that time with a great block. There it is, what we talked about at the beginning of the broadcast, Frank. It was execution, blocking. There wasn't anything magic about it. And it was great running by Donovan, who finds his paths in that open field brilliantly.
He did a good job right there. If you notice, he almost stopped dead in his tracks and then started up again, which shows you the ability he has to even spin those wheels on a day like today.
Well, it's a thinking back, Frank. It's the mark of a great back when he has the capacity to think as he runs and see what the lane is and not just take off because he lets the blockers come to him. The kick by Duffy is deep, sailing over the head of Sparango, who's going to have to go back and pick it up, and pick it up he does, to the 5, to the 10. He meets opposition at the 15, and he's dropped at the 18 as Sean Duffy took off with that ball. Bart Sparango sprinted back with the ball, and he was knocked down by number 40, Darryl Garner, on the kickoff team of West. And so with 1:07 to go, and the Bucks on top, 6-0.
I think he let that ball sail over his head, hoping it was going to go into the end zone, as it would be a touchback, but the mud just held it up.
Tommy Dennis checks into the football game at fullback. Clark Paulus calls the signals.
There's unbalance again, Marv.
Telling the play to Dennis, who just checked in a little late. Give it off the wall, straight ahead, no room. He is hit immediately, Frank. And the guy who came across and made the excellent hit on him was Nick Angel, the left tackle, right tackle defensively for West, who was not blocked. And so the football shows no gain for Chris Wall, coming power right. And a play being sent in with Brian Price from the sideline. Also coming into the ball game is Joe Moore, is number 31. As East shuttles some plays in, Tommy Dennis comes out of the ball game, 27, 26, 25. In this, the first quarter, 6-0. The Bucks on top of the Patriots. to the flank. Sparango to the flank. Moores, double flanker. Moores in motion. They hand it off inside the wall. Wall looking for some running room. Has some. Gets across the 20 as they did a pretty good job, Frank, on that trap.
That's a good looking play right there. It's not quite a trap, Marv. I forget the name of it, but instead of having the guard pulling and trapping, they had the motion fullback wall.
The wing back comes back.
Yeah, the wing back does the trapping right there. Yeah. And it's a real pretty play. It worked for him.
Say the wing tee classic. And Frank, 6-0. The first quarter is over. The teams change fields, and we take a break. Wide open, Fahey, as Fahey came off the tight end position, Frank, and they had good that time. They worked the pattern that they didn't work before.
He had him, too. It was the first pass of the game by either team. And
no, the second. Wallace threw one down here when we thought that the same route
early
was run
down.
Wrong. This time it was run right, but he doesn't get the ball there. So it'll be fourth down, and East will be punting the football, and Tim Donovan will be deep, and back in a punt formation was Teddy Frisch, the big tight end of East who does their punting. Let's see if West comes after him. Last time the snap was high, this time it's fine. He gets it away. It's a good kick, driving Donovan back to the 45. Donovan heads for the sideline, looking for a chance to get outside, but he is hit and brought down across the field in the mud at the 46-yard line.
Jeff Japsen,
the big tight end and captain of Central Bucks East, did a great job. And if you take a look at Japsen, he cannot see. He is a mud ball. I imagine Donovan is too, because he was on the bottom. But the ball, Frank, will rest across the 50 at the 48-yard line the Patriots.
I hope they can get a shot of that. He really is blinded in the mud, in the blood, in the beer.
So the Bucks with a 6-0 lead at the 11:45 mark of the first half. We're in the second quarter of this football game. The Bucks on a 39-yard great run by Donovan.
Donovan looks just as bad on the other sideline, Marv. There's a referee's timeout for Jeff Japsen to clear out his eyes, I can imagine.
Yeah, he's got a towel. They're bringing it out down there, Frank. That's what you see going on in the center of your field where the official is standing with the manager and Japsen, because he came into the mud, but he made an excellent, excellent play.
VHS copies of today's game are available, and all you have to do is dial 345-5151, ask for Jim Bunn or any of the helpful people at Home-Vue Cable, and you can get your own cassette of this game or any of the other games broadcast by Home-Vue this year.
David Porter has come into the football game. A young sophomore has played well for East. They line it up now for the Bucks. Give it off to Kilkenny, and he slips as he starts out and play a middle guard. Jeff Cott, together with number 78, Stephen Schilt, come in there to put the touch on him, and he gets just about back to the line of scrimmage, Frank. We'll call it no gain and bring up a second down and 10. The Bucks bring Tim Donovan back in as Darryl Garner had given Tim a rest just to get that mud out of him. 6-0 West, football resting on the 48-yard line, second and 10. You got Kilkenny the up back, Donovan the deep back, Baggett standing on the right shoulder of Kilkenny, and Clark calls the signals. To Donovan, sweeping, breaks a tackle, and then he is hit and brought down by number 42, Tommy Dennis, coming from his linebacker position to read it, but not until he gains, well, we'll call it 3 yards, Frank. Move the football down to the 45 and bring up a third down and 7.
That's a real nice charge by the offensive line of the Bucks, coming off very low, and the lower you come off on a day like this, the better your leverage, and consequently, the better your blocking.
Messenger man is Bill Clark coming into the huddle. You got Cott in the middle. Noren Schilt the tackles. Japsen and Teddy Dennis the ends. Gatto and Tommy Dennis are at the linebackers, with Price, Cronin, Porter, and Patterson the secondary. Clark rolling, draw, gives it off. This time running the football is Baggett, and he is no place as Eric Knorr slammed in from one side to jar him, and Jeff Cott read his block well, and Cott is twice now. Made a difference, Frank, in this muddy field. The big guy weighs 275 or 280 is hurting, and on the sidelines, that's a big up for the Patriots.
He's a good player. He's probably playing the best game of his career right now, and it has a lot to do with the field because he gets going one direction and it's hard to head him off the pass.
Standing deep are Sparango and Price, and back to punt it is Walt Wandel. 9:39 and counting, 6-0. Patriots lining up. Will they come after it or will they try to hold? No, they're holding. Kick is away. It spins to Sparango. He picks it up and then he is met and dropped as he had some indecision down there. And Darryl Garner, again, number 40 of the Bucks, was down there to make the hit, and the football will rest at the 20-yard line, and that's actually decent field position, Frank, in this kind of a day.
Yeah, well, so far it's been a game just of that field position, and West is winning 6-0, but as far as the whole scheme of things going, they're winning by more than that because of the field position.
Well, let's see what the Patriots do at this point, Frank.
Well, they're coming out unbalanced, and so far that has not worked for them.
Give it off to Wall. Wall running hard. Gets a decent block in there from Tommy Dennis and hammers his way up to the 25-yard line. That's 5 yards, Frank.
Caparo and Baggett had to make the tackle. Now, that's one thing you do as a coach is when you go with the unbalance, of course, they expect you to go to the heavy side of the line. You run back to the short side of the line and hope to catch a nap, and then they did. Apparently, they got a 5-yard gain on first down.
Jeff Bernhard, the fine fullback, back from an early season injury, is giving him a good ball game today. And you got Bernhard and Wall. Bernhard lining up on the upside. They drop Japson off and move him in motion. West shifts to adjust. Toss to Wall. And they've taken too much time, Frank, as Bernhard was somewhat confused on the side he was lining up to.
Well, East is pointing to West, and apparently it's going to be
Maybe
that
it
way.
Is. Frank, I misread that, and I'm not going to do that again. West, apparently, in their anxiety to make the shift, may have encroached.
Right. I think that's what happened. They went to a Y off. The tight end is a Y. They bring him off the line of scrimmage. And when he's on the line of scrimmage and steps back a yard, that's, you know, if you're down on the inside of the line, you can construe that as motion, and I think that's what happened.
Okay.
Perfectly legal by East and smart, too.
A foot, Frank.
Now, here's a play where you might look for a pass, Marv. It's second down and about a foot. Perfect situation for a play pass.
Sparango comes wide to this side, and he's picked up on coverage by Steve Clark. Bucks in a 50 front. No, they sneak it with Paulus carrying a football, and Paulus has the first down behind an excellent block by Eddie Coverdale, who fired out and took on the Buck nose guard and rammed him back about three.
He really got under him.
So first and 10 for the Patriots at the 33-yard line of the Patriots, Frank. 8 minutes to play in this, the first quarter, 6-0, Central Bucks West leading the Patriots of Central Bucks East in what's been, for this kind of a day, Frank, an interesting and tight and hard-fought game. Paulus calls the signals. Wing is Moore's. Paulus to Wall. Wall trying to find running room, gets no places, penetrating for the Bucks was 40, Darryl Garner, and number 32, Chris Westcott. And both of them had a good charge and beat the blockers.
Well, again, it's back to the play we just saw previously, and that was the short side unbalanced play, and they had good success with it on first down before, so they come back with the same play to the other side on first down, and they get 2 yards or perhaps just a yard, Marv.
Football at the 35-yard line, 2nd and 9. Bernhard and Wall behind Paulus. Paulus on the delay to Wall, and Wall gets 2. Just about 2. Moves the football to the 38-yard line, and that's in the middle of the worst of the field conditions right there, Frank.
Yeah, it's getting noticeably worse as the game proceeds, and going to be that much harder to put together a drive.
So the third down, Frank, a big 3rd and 7 for the Patriots. Football at the 37. We're going to call it the 37. Let's see what happens here. Back to throw, Paulus looking. Paulus going to throw. He's going to be hit and dropped. He's going to be hit and dropped. It's coming in, Frank, from the backside for the Bucks was Chris Groves as Paulus waited to throw. But the real credit, I think, Frank, should go to the secondary of the Bucks, who had great coverage and he couldn't release the ball.
That's right. They just tried to throw a little slant right there, and he was covered before he could shake free of the defender. The defensive lineman jumped on his back. It's going to be 4th down from about the 29-yard line. Tim Donovan waits for the punt as an East player is assisted off the field. I think he just got
Eddie
mud in his
Coverdale,
eye.
Frank. I think Eddie just taking his helmet off as he comes over here under the guidance of Dr. Vince Mena. He may just have taken a blow to the belly. One of those kind of, I hope that's all it is, because they could ill afford to lose that good center.
That's right.
Now they have to have a snapper, I think, Frank. They got to get somebody in to snap, and that changes something in the football game.
That is a big difference.
And the guy they're bringing in to do the snapping is Chris Naughton, number 67, rowboat Naughton, the last of the nautical Naughtons.
No, 44 is going to do the snapping for him.
Naughton's going to block. 44 is preparing to snap the football, and that's Mike Fahey. It's a low snap, but West wasn't coming, and he got it away, and it's a spinning, twisting kick. Donovan at the 40, 45. Donovan slips and go down at the 47-yard line as he attempted to make the outside cut, and I think he's got away with one, Frank.
Hey, that was a good exchange right there. They're back in their own end of the field, and that was about a 30-some-odd-yard kick.
Plus, they did without their usual snapper cover down West. Next time, I think you can look for, if that's the case, for West to come. So at the 5:56 mark, the football resting at the 46-yard line. West is in possession, and they'd like to put a drive on and get at least a three, maybe a bigger score, to seal up before the half. Four-man front. Daw by Clark, and it's read nicely on the inside for the Patriots. Eric Knorr, the left tackle, once again had an excellent read, and that was jammed on the outside by Japshin.
Well, it's a play they've been using with not too much success today. It's a quarterback draw, and the reason it's not so successful is people aren't afraid of the pass today, and they see the quarterback dropping back, and instead of immediately thinking pass, they immediately think quarterback draw or fullback draw, something of that sort, and it only got him 2 yards. Hasn't been that successful for him.
Field level view of the mud and the wet. Motion this way. That's Baggett. He's pumping hard. Clark gives it off to Donovan. On the counter, he can't get footing, and it's jammed on the opposite side by Gatto, the linebacker, with assistance, Frank, on the far side by Schilt, the tackle, and Schilt has played very well today, Frank, from the defensive right tackle. They're pinching and cutting off the inside stuff and depending on their defensive ends to hold their own.
That's right.
So we have a third down, Frank, and we're going to call it, we'll call it six, third and six for the Bucks. The clock continues to wind down in the first half, 6-0 Bucks. Football right at just the nose of the football, over the 50. Big third and six play coming up as Stevie Clark tosses to Donovan. Donovan to the 50, breaks one tackle but can't get out of the arms of Gatto, who came up and made a good inside hit and drove him into the mud ball over there, and had plenty of assistance to help him out from Tommy Dennis, the linebacker, who has begun to really be mobile at his linebacker post. And I think, Frank, what's happening is that the mud is slowing Timmy up as he comes, but the East defense is also playing very determinedly today. You see the sideline over here, Frank, on your monitors. You can see on your screen the way the boards are down. They're trying to keep some semblance of keeping these kids out of the mud, and the staff as well. Wandahl back to boot it. And waiting for it are Price and Sparango. They're down around their own 20-yard line.
Fake.
It's a fake, and the play does not work, Frank. The play doesn't work. East came up with a football. Looked like a fumble.
No,
number 56,
Mark,
Teddy Dennis? Huh?
I think what happened, believe it or not, I've never seen it happen before, but I think the center just lost the handle on it before he ever made the snap. The ball got stuck in the mud.
I think you're absolutely right. It's a weird. That'll have to get down, Frank, in our album of the all-time weirdest plays.
He started to draw his hands back, and he did, and the point of the ball stuck in the ground, and it's going to be East first down on their 49-yard best field position of the day.
49-yard line for East. Motion this way comes Bernhard. The toss to Sparango. He reads it nicely and gets good yardage, Frank.
He did.
He read it very, very well as he cut back.
He was hit by Kilkenny near the line of scrimmage, but he was able to buck underneath him. And Bill was trying to hit him a little bit too hard, raised up on him, and Sparango dove underneath him for about 3.5 yards.
Okay, well, we'll make it an even three.
All right.
Second and seven, Frank. Second down, seven. Football at the 47-yard line of the Bucks, and that's the first time today that East has been in Buck territory after that unusual play on that center snap. Paulus back to throw. Paulus throws the football, and it is complete, Frank, for a first down at the 39-yard line as Clark Paulus completes the first pass of the day.
Well, as we were saying, the field conditions make it such that your offense doesn't have to be as effective to win. One or two breaks, as we had right there, that was one turnover. You get a turnover, that can enable your offense to score the points it needs to win the game. And at this point, all they need is one touchdown.
There's an official timeout, Frank, and they haven't stopped the clock. They have not stopped the clock, Frank. The official had been signaling for timeout for almost 10 seconds, and the clock continued to run. The clock's at 2:28. The official, apparently, Frank, see him on the sideline talking to John Kaplan. There's something that he wants.
Yeah, he
wants
was asking a for a towel.
A clock continued to run down. It ran down to 2:28. These two teams want to go at it.
Well, I guess he has to do a little housekeeping out there, and he's going to offer the towel to the quarterback. That's exactly what he did. It's probably a little beyond his scope of duties, but on a day like today, it's a special case.
Frank, they're putting the towel in the back of Norm Bowell. They're putting the towel in the back of Norman Bowell, number 65, the fine senior offensive guard. And I guess they're going to let him wear it instead of Coverdale for the hand-wiping purposes. Clock now starts to run. It'll be first and 10 at the 39. Fahey, wide to the lower part of your screen. Clark Paulus, one setback. Paulus back to throw. He throws it deep. It's going to be intercepted. It's going to be intercepted as Paulus couldn't get the ball deep enough. And the man who did it was number 22, Billy Clark of the Bucks. And on that play, Frank, if he had been able to launch that football, right, Fahey was behind Clark.
Well, I think, and with all due respect, the reason Fahey was behind Clark was that he immediately saw that it was going to be an underthrown ball. I think he did have him covered, in my opinion.
Frankie had an up receiver. Uh-huh. He was deciding whether to move on the up receiver. There was a coverage breakdown. The linebacker didn't pick the flat.
Well, anyways, we've got to give a lot of respect to the defensive lineman who draped himself over Paulus because he was the one that made him throw short.
See what happens here now. Under 2 minutes and counting.
Unbalanced.
Clark on the draw, and Cronin comes up and cuts him. Rob Cronin cuts him at the 30-yard line.
And it's a good thing he did.
The yard, because he had room to go. If Clark gets by and Cronin doesn't make that play, sideline was open. Only Price coming from the safety spot could have helped. So we're 140, 6-0 West. As East went to the air, Coach Kalpin, would have been interesting, Frank, on a dry day because Donovan's cuts would have been there. These two teams would have really gone after. We had some scoring.
I think mud is really a great equalizer. And
that's because you're a great big mud ball.
I am. I'm a mudder.
I formation, first time. Straight ahead. Clark on the fake. Keeps it running. He is hit, and down he goes as they help him out as Price comes up. And the football, Frank, is dead at the 35-yard line where it'll bring up a third down. And East has been very good on supporting, Frank. And, Frank, the best part of this first half has been the total penalty yardage. On a lousy day, 5 yards, an encroachment, one time by West. That's the only penalties we've had. That's a tribute to the coaching and the play of both these teams. And, Frank, time is taken by East. 1:02 to play, 6 for the Bucks, nothing for the Patriots, as both teams have come with what the best possible games they could bring in a muddy day. And the 39-yard first quarter burst by Tim Donovan, it looms bigger and bigger as neither team now, Frank, seems able to muster a sustained offense.
Well, John Kaplan's shown a lot of confidence in his defense. It's third down and about 3 yards to go. He says that he thinks his defense can stop him on this play, force him to punt, get the ball back, and try to score once before the half.
Well, it'll be an interesting thing, Frank, because to score today, you're going to either have to have a run like Donovan made where you break somebody out into the open, or you're going to have somebody wide open on a pass, because now the wind on the far end, Frank, our camera will sometime during the ballgame pick up the flag. The great big stadium flag is blowing dead away, and that'll be the sign of the wind. You see Coach Pettin in there. Look at the jerseys, the white jerseys. By the end of this second half, Frank, they'll be unrecognizable. We're going to do it on prayer profile. So the football is at the 36-yard line. It is third down, about 2.5, 3 yards to go. Let's see it now. Big Radigan over the ball. Clark, long count. Clark back to throw, rolls out, and he is hit and brought down by Eric Knorr on a positively superb defensive play by Eric Knorr, who just handled the buck blocker like he wasn't there. And Frank, this East team, when they want to play defense, show you they can, because nobody has handled the front line of the Bucks like this year.
He tried to get hip pocket of the guard, and what that means is the guard was pulling towards us right now, and what happened is Knorr followed him, got such a good jump on him, he was able to come across the face of the guard, defeat his leverage, and take himself right to the quarterback. Great play, fourth down and 5. Big play for CB East. They got a chance to score before the half with only 53 seconds left, but they are going to receive a punt.
Now, Frank, in this timeout, which Mike Pettin has taken, I suspect what Mike is doing in there is checking it off pretty carefully. In the event of a bad snap, this. In the event of this, and see what you got coming, because
right,
they can sit back, Frank, a little bit at this point. They just don't want to turn it over any
right
close.
I think you're probably right. He's going over letter by letter the rules of blocking for the punt team, and because he does anticipate, rightly so, a block by the East squad. You got to watch number 22, Robbie Kernan. I think he's going to be one of the guys, along with number 27. He's going to be one of the guys that sneak up at the end and try to get the block off the...
Walt Wandell on your screen, waiting for the snap. Perfect snap from Big Radigan. Almost blocked, Frank. Almost. And the kick
splits
out of bounds. And it'll be East ball, Frank. It'll be East ball. I think what they ruled, Frank, was the punt blocker got underneath the kicking foot and the man slipped on his own momentum. He did not make contact with him. And they darn near almost blocked that punt.
Yeah, unless he did rule that he touched the ball. He might have even done that.
That's possible. He may have, Frank, because he pointed in this direction with his hand. One way or another, he's coming with a quick offense. The football at the 49-yard line, 47 seconds to play in the first half. 6-0, the Bucks. And the Buck defense has not been any slouch today either. And the ball is thrown out of bounds by Paulus to stop the clock. Shot put it by Paulus to the sideline. He stops it with 46 seconds. And in that field position, Frank, they have nothing to lose by getting more time to work the ball because there's no way they could possibly move the ball quickly enough with the clock running to use up the full three plays they might get now. And indeed, Frank, they may very well take the full three plays here rather than punt. Break the huddle. Deep back is Bernhard. Motion Sparango. Wall on the wing. Paulus back to throw, fumbles the football and falls on it. Clark Paulus trying to pull out. The ball slipped out of his hands, and today, Frank, that's something that can happen. It hasn't happened often, but it can happen. So the clock now continues to run. East lining up in a quick lineup. We're down to 30 seconds, and this is the first half. Paulus calls his signal. Paulus back to throw. Paulus looking. Throws it deep, looking deep for Fahey, then the ball is pass interference, Frank. There's an interference call with 18 seconds to go as the ball was intercepted, Frank, by Matt Baggett, but the official with a very late flag has ruled apparently there's interference. Now the question is it defense or offense?
I think it was defensive pass interference.
I think
it
he climbed on his back, Frank.
Yeah, I believe so. Like a basketball play. The balls, they're waiting for the ball to come down, and Baggett put his hands on him and boxed him out. It's really a tough call. He could have got away with not calling it, but it's a valid PI call.
He was too, just Baggett and his intensity to come up on it. A very close play. Just got there in the opinion of the official
right.
Just a second too
late. Well, the argument you get into is that both players have the right to go for the ball. And I think it's valid because he did kind of try to box him out and put his elbows on him, but it's going to be an exciting play for East. It's going to be first down from about the 39-yard line. Marv, 18 seconds.
Exactly, Frank. First and 10. But what they can do now, I think the best, Frank, they can hope for almost is they call a timeout.
Yeah.
They want to talk it over, and you see John Paulus coming to the sideline with John Calpin, the East team huddling on your monitor.
There's Mike Pettin right now going to the referee, hands in his pockets. Well, you know that means he's mad, and he's saying that's a bad call, but he should. He's the one that had it go against him.
Frank, in all these interference situations that we've seen over the year, and except in the most obvious cases, I think that's the toughest call for an official to make in football. That and peculiarly, the goal line, the short smack at the goal line with the ball on the foot line and the body's piling and hitting.
Well, as I said, it gets into a division of who has which lane to the ball. And that situation right there, Baggett was the one that was in front of the receiver, and it was an underthrown ball. So the receiver almost had to come back over Baggett's back, but in the same vein, Baggett was boxing him out and touching him with his hands and stuff like that. So it's a tough call, no argument on this side.
All Matt wanted to do was come Baggett.
That's right.
And he did.
That's right.
They got the flag on him. So, Frank, with 18 seconds to go and the football at the 39-yard line, John Calpin may say, look, if we can get 18 or 20 yards, maybe we can give Foley a chance. The wind is with him. The wind is with the East kicker. They might settle for a three. Who knows? But this West defense, Frank, thus far today, has played very, very sound football in tough situations. Let's see what we've got happening right now. Got two backs, Bernhard and Wall. Paulus back to throw. Paulus has a man. Oh, and it's over the shoulder of Fahey. As he was open behind the coverage, and coming sprinting with him was Billy Kilkenny, the linebacker who has to take him, and the ball would have down on the ground at the 30-yard line. So 14 seconds, they use up four, second and 10. Had that ball been completed, Frank, I think you'd have seen a quick timeout call. I think the Patriots have but one timeout remaining. So let's see what happens now.
Ed Coverdale, just for your notice, is back in the game, feeling fine.
Long huddle, Patriots break it. Wall, Bernhard, and Sparango Fahey and Price together with Sparango. They're going to come flood and fly on this left side, lower part of your screen. Paulus looking under some pressure, fires it. He's got his man Sparango. Sparango breaks a tackle. He's got a first down across the 25 to the 24-yard line of the Bucs. There's only 6 seconds left, and the Patriots will have to use their last timeout. And now Coach Kalpin has an important decision to make. Let's see, Frank. Football rests at the 20. We'll call it the 25, but I think it's too long a gun.
I think the decision is made for him. Let alone the field conditions. If it was a nice day, it's too far for him. He's in a good situation here because now he can throw one ball into the end zone and go for it right now.
The key is getting the time to throw, right, Frank, because I'm almost certain that what Mike Pettine will do right now, knowing that they're going to flood people like they did on the last pattern, is he's going to blow somebody in off that backside to Paulus, who's, because the footing for the quarterback, right, the mobility is not good. And look at Coach Kalpin on the screen. He's shuffling and jumping. He just brought Joey Moore's 31 right into the football
give
game,
some,
a fresh
give
back.
Some instruction right now.
Nice.
That's
and
a good
Joe
camera
out
shot.
Brings Price in. Everybody's coming in and out here, and whatever it is.
Well, you like it because, as I said, he can take the ball and throw it into the end zone and not have to worry about doing it two times. Before, you know, it almost would take him two passes to get down into the end zone, and they completed the first one. Now the second part of the series here has to take him into the end zone in order for them to score a touchdown or else get a PI.
They put Brian Price on the far side, and the problem is getting Mike Pettine off the field. Mike doesn't want to leave. He wants the old Villanova defensive back once in there. He's still on the field. Back to throw goes Paulus. He's looking, fires to Fahey. Fahey drops the ball with 1 second, Frank, as he threw to Fahey. That was as good as he could do on it, Frank. As Fahey came down and out to the sideline, and Price was moving behind him. Looking
See,
for an out and up by Price, but it isn't going to be there. It's a launch that he's got to
That's
get.
Right. That's not going to help him. Even if he completes that pass, the half is over. So he's got to throw the ball into the end zone. There's no two ways about it.
They break the huddle. Let's see. Fahey, tight end, Sparango, and Moores with a single set. The Bucs are coming. The Bucs are coming. They're going to get him. He tosses the football, and it's knocked down. Paulus made.
Drew Wolf.
Just drew the ball away from him, and Drew Wolf, talking about Drew, was the guy that was on top of him. And Frank, as the half ends, it is 6 for the Bucs. Nothing for the Patriots in what's been a very good first half of a very good football game. Not a boring game, and you see the teams coming off the field. And just take a look at these kids who have really played a good half of football. And we'll be back as we take a break.
Marvin, Frank, I'm standing out here in this wet Saturday afternoon. The score 6-0 for West. But I'm standing here with Chuck Cotman, who is assistant coach for the Patriots. And I just wanted to ask him a question. Looks like you're still in the game. It's only 6-0. And although it's wet, it's kept you in the game so far against the Bucs.
Oh, without a doubt. You know, we feel that we come out the second half. We can hold them on this initial drive, pin them down deep in their territory. We'll be kicking off. That we can make them punt, get a good field position, go in and win this game 7-6 possibly.
Well, thanks a lot, Chuck. Appreciate you taking the time. I know you want to get back to the team. Appreciate you coming over.
Thank you.
Again, the weather certainly hasn't changed. It's still as muddy as it was, and you can see the field out here is just a quagmire now out in the mud. But the defense of East has stood in there pretty well, and again, it's only 6-0. So I'll turn it back over to you, Marvin Frank, upstairs.
Norm, we don't envy you down there. I went down at the halftime, and it is absolutely raining much worse than it did before. There's some wind which has come up in the middle of the second quarter. And, Frank, in this, the second half, perhaps what Coach Chuck Cotman uttered would be the desired circumstance for East. They want to get the ball and pin West up, but I'm positive that Coach Mike Pettin at this point is saying, look, we got to take this kickoff and make as good a drive as we've made all year. Frank, how do you see this second half?
Well, I see it as an extension of the first half, no different. I think that West is going to go with what was working for him, and that's ground control offense, just Kilkenny and Donovan. I think maybe, as you said, Ben is a smart player, and he's realized he can't cut as much as he did before. CB West, if you notice, has changed uniforms, and they have a whole brand new set on each one of their players, so that might aid them slightly at the beginning of the half. I think that, as Coach Cotman was saying, you got to be pretty happy with the way things are right now. 6 points is not an insurmountable lead by any stretch, so CB East is still back in the ballgame, and it's going to be strictly two things are going to carry him. It's going to be emotion and ability. I think they have the emotion, and I think they have the ability.
Frank, one of the things that becomes factor also is this, the weight of the rain and the mud on the players, because they begin to carry 15 or 20 more pounds with water and the field conditions. And I see, Frank, that whether or not the two teams at this point can establish, either one of them, establish positive field position at the beginning of the first half, you have to see that it has not been the kind of grinding, wearing down game in which that 15 or 20 pounds would show any effect early.
Well, one thing to remember is this also, that people are creatures of habits, and the habit for CB West on this day is to get out front of CB East and stay that way, and conversely, CB East is used, or this class is at least, used to losing the West on the last game of the year. So we'll see if that has any kind of a fatalist attitude about it, because CB West, I think, is really emotionally excited and on a roll. They know they're one half away from an undefeated number one season, and they're real excited about it. Right now you watch Dick Beck, who's a real wild man out there, and he's leading them on. He's wearing number 68, so you note he has changed jerseys, but seems some kind of tribal totem dance out there, and he's charging his players up, and they're going to use that emotion for the rest of this half, Marv. And East needs that same kind of emotion, and they seem to have it too.
Frank, I don't think East is going to back off, and I'm not sure that there's a question of used to losing to people, because in the last 2 years they've split the two ball games. So when you suggest that this team has come in here feeling that they're defeated, I think they've come in here playing very well and with certainly a positive attitude in mind. But the thing that impresses me about Central Bucks West is that they have not deviated from the very basic things that they have done all year well. Their essential formations, Mike lines them up the same way. If he really has got about, he's got a million sets, but three basic methods of attack. They haven't thrown the football yet. The water has caused them to go on the ground. They could start to throw the ball in this half. That might open up for them to take advantage of very short passing game. And Clark's role, the East secondary, to come up and cover the corner. They're attacking quickly. They may get something out of that. But it seems to me, Frank, that the essence of this football game in the second half is perhaps beyond each of these young men. It may very well be in just some mistake, some little thing, which sets it off. The next touchdown by West will make it very, very tough for East to come back and win this ball game. It's that kind of a day. It's a one or two touchdown game day.
Right.
On the other hand, if East were to get ahead, that in turn might motivate them. So we got a lot of football left to play in the second half, and we'll be back with it all, Frank Case. Well, 6-0, and Sean Duffy, as West is elected, to kick off, and that's a wise move. They want East to handle the football. Duffy's kick is short to Sparango. No, it comes to Patterson, 20. Patterson looking for room, gets a block, 25. Fights his way forward on a hard run as Timmy Patterson came up gamely at the 29-yard line, and a lot of credit because he got a good block from Bart Sparingo to give him about an extra 6 yards.
Jeff Lively and Drew Wolf on the tackle and the kickoff.
The young sophomore Lively, and Wolf, who's played very well today, and Frank will have to keep checking jerseys because West has some people in different jerseys.
That's right. Well, you'll have to bear with us. Strategically, that's an interesting move by Mike Pettin. He had the choice to kick off or receive, and he chose to kick off to follow the same pattern in the first half. Keep him down there in bad field position. Unbalanced line by East, Marv. West adjusts.
Back to the backside to Wall, and it is a nice move in there by number 54 of West, who is Chris Groves, coming from the opside, and he stops the play for no gain as they came for the short side, Frank, which worked last time, didn't this time, as Groves right. Makes the fine defensive play.
Well, I think he stunted to the long side of the line right there and was able to cut back and make the tackle for no gain. Again, unbalanced to this side, Marv.
Same way they did in this half. Price is on the wing. Sparingo to Wall, looking for running room, and Wall bangs ahead. And Dick. He gets a couple of yards, and number 68, Dick Beck, makes the tackle for West. Beck in that New Jersey this time. We'll give him about three, move the ball to the 33-yard line, bring up a third down and 7 for the Patriots. And the field is absolutely... Norm Stanley said this field was a quagmire, Frank, and I'd have to say to him that if that means it's unbelievable, that there is no footing. You sink into it about up to your ankle when you step in it. Third down, 7 play. Wingbacks are Moores and Wall, or rather Sparingo and Wall. Paulus throwing the football, has a man. Sparingo has the ball completed. He completes it, and it is a heck of a pass, Frank, on a wet day like this. And the ball rests at the 47-yard line. And, Frank, right before the half, we talked about the idea that East could throw the football, that they had receivers open.
The thing I like that Paulus did right there, he looked down the middle of the field to Fahey. Fahey was covered, and then Drew Baggett over to cover Fahey as he was looking at him. Stepped back, went to his second receiver, found him for a first down, moving into West territory on their own 47.
Now he's at the 47 of East, Frank.
That's what I meant, moving into West territory.
Oh, going on the roll. Almost a fumble. They get it in there to Sparingo, and he twists and turns and moves forward with a gutsy run. And he moves
forward
to the 50. Let's see what happens, Frank.
Apparently not, but no. West was hoping it was. It's going to be just this on the other side, Marv.
Frank, the ball, you ever seen those desserts they call them mud pies? They're full of fudge and ice cream. That's what that ball looks like in there. And it's no fault on Clark Paulus or any football player here today if that ball slips as they come breaking out. Second down and 6. To Wall, breaks the tackle and hammers across behind an excellent block by Jeffcott. And Wall works his way to about the 46-yard line of the Bucks. Football at the 46, it'll be third, Frank, and 3, a very long 3. 9:17 to play, 6-0 West. But this drive behind the excellent pass from Paulus to Sparingo is changing the field position.
We have I believe we're gonna have refrigerator formation, Marv. Jeff Cotts to the left in your backfield.
Let's see how they block it, Frank. Give it to Wall. He gets a block from Cott, and he gets very close to the first down, Frank. Cott delivered a heck of a block on Drew Wolf.
As an East player.
That's Fingleton who's down, Frank. The football, let's see. It's timeout to measure.
That's a good looking play. Jeff Cott was a lead back blocker right there, and he took on the defensive end, knocked him down, and was able to spring a nice hole for the running back.
And they're using Mike Brown at an offensive tackle, and that I think Coach Calpin's trying to rotate his people a little more. As Tommy Fingleton is the man who was down, and we're waiting for the measurement. We hope Tom is fine. Doc Vince Mena examining him. They're short, Frank, about, you see Jeff Japshin. He says we're short about 1 inch. We're still attending to Tom Fingleton with 8:51 to play, and East just about an inch away from a first down. Football resting at the 43, we'll call it the 43-yard line. And Frank, while we have a little time for this injury, let's mention some of the people not only have been with us in the broadcast today, but some of the people who have been with us all year who are the sponsors who make this possible. And if people enjoy Home-Vue Television, they ought to be able to let these people know. We do
well, the
like it.
The business sports team is Richards 2 Restaurant, Mount Lake Pool and Patio, Delaware Valor College, where we are right now, Smith Marine, Landis & Son Carpentry, Barb Lynn Carpets, McCroskey Music, Carl Eber Machine Shop, New Bolds, of course, Shawnee at High Point, Kingsbury Realtors, and Doylestown Federal Savings and Loan, fourth down and inches, Marv.
The block, key block will be Coverdale. They're going to sneak for it. They've got it, Frank. Coverdale delivered. Eddie Coverdale fired out on the middle guard and delivered it.
Fired out and fired up. Right now, the CB East team is getting very fired up, and as I said, emotion is going to be the key.
8:35. And counting.
Ed Coverdale had a real nice block, and he's going to set the line for the Patriots right now.
41-yard line, I formation, wall the up back. Motion Bernhard. The toss to Sparango. He hangs on to the football, follows the block, and comes forward. As he bangs his way inside the 40 down to the 39, and leading it up for the Patriots was number 50, Mark Gatto, that came forward and delivered the initial block to give Sparango credit, because on a tough day, Frank, he ran good. He ran well. Kept his feet and kept driving, and that's not easy. So, second and six, Frank.
This is by far the most impressive drive they've put together all day, Marv.
To Wall. Big guy bangs across. The 35 is at about the 34, where Billy Kilkenny, doing a good job of shutting the block, fills in. And once again, Kilkenny making another good play as he has all year. Fine co-captain. But a good block again by Gatto, who's leading it up through, Frank. So the football is third down at the 35-yard line, and they've got, well, we'll call it 2 to 3 yards to make. The Bucks digging in. Paulus calls the signals. Strong right formation. Paulus hands it to Wall. Wall has running room. Wall has the first down and more as he hammers his way behind. Superb blocking. Really, Frank, an outstanding block again by Jeff Cott, and a great block by the tight end. And they came strong, that formation. The up back led it through well, and they have put the football on the 25-yard line of the Bucks. And this is the best drive of the day by either team on a sustained basis.
Well, obviously, the momentum has shifted right now. It's going to be a first down from about the 26-yard line for CB and CB East, and they're excited.
Balanced line, motion Bernhard, I formation. Toss to Sparango. He runs into Gatto. And he gets only short yardage as Bill Kilkenny sheds the block to come up to put him down. He gets, well, I don't know if he got anything, Frank. Nothing. So it'll be second and 10.
Here's where the yardage gets tough right now, down inside the 30-yard line. And I was just going to say, Mike's strategy seemed to have backfired on him, Marv.
Well, it doesn't yet, because they haven't been hurt yet. They've just been put to the test, and they've met that test many a time. Bucks. And a split five defense to give it off to Wall. Wall has some running room, Frank. And the blocker Bernhard and the blocker Japshin have made the play there as Wall read that right, Frank. He saw the opening.
He did. Well, they got a nice block on Ken Button, the nose guard, I believe. And that enabled them to get that initial 4 yards, third down and six.
Frank, you got a man down for the Bucks. We hope he's not injured, as Dr. Burmeister is out there. This wet weather, Frank, anything can happen on those situations.
Well, that's exactly true. You get your foot planted and it slips out from underneath you, and it's easy to strain or injure severely a tendon or a ligament or something like that, or even pull a muscle. Like, for instance, groin muscles are especially susceptible to this kind of weather, because you're planted and all of a sudden your foot slips out to the side and could just really do some damage to one of your...
Frank, they got 6 yards to make here on third down, and the football is resting at the 20, we're going to mark it at the 21-yard line. We're actually going to call it seven, third and seven. They've actually, for a first down, have got to get to the 15-yard line. That'll be what they'll have to do. And coming into the ball game for the Bucks is Doug Mims, number 80, if that is him. We can't verify the jerseys, so if somebody's in the game or not in the game, I hope the fans will bear with us, because his jersey switch has made it tough for us to speak accurately about who's there. We have 5:58 in the third quarter remaining, 6-0 the Bucks. The Patriots have taken the opening kickoff as West elected to give it the football, hoping to cause him to be jammed up inside. And Frank, I don't like the amount of time they're taking with a young man who's down. I hope this is nothing serious.
We'd like to remind you that Central Bucks West class of 1976 is planning its 10th year reunion. And for any information, please call 828-4548. For the Central Bucks West Class of 76 10th year reunion.
Frank, down on the field, Norm Stanley has a report. Norm, what's up?
We've got a couple injuries, one on the east side, but it looks like Mr. Fingleton is back in, and it looks like he's got a knee injury. I'll go on the west side, Frank and Marv, to check and see what that injury is, see how extensive it is, and I'll be back to you as soon as I have some word. Back to you.
Let's hope it's very good word, Norm. And we're waiting. It's a prolonged timeout, and this young man who's down, and we can't tell what number that is, Frank, has not moved since Dr. Burmeister got out there. So this is a very, very prolonged timeout with the football resting at the 20. Well, now we see clearly it's at the 21. They got to make the 15. We're going to call it 6 yards to go when we resume action. And Dr. Vince Mena, the scoreboard shows you the positioning. And while our camera hasn't picked it up yet, Frank, Dr. Vince Mena has come out to assist out there. Here you see him in the yellow slicker.
Uh-huh.
And so the entire medical staff available here today is leaning over this young man. And I certainly, Frank, it's probably the one lousy moment in the whole game of football.
That's right. And let's take this opportunity of inactivity here to mention our cameraman. Right now, Chris Strain is working the one camera up top. Down low, we have Jim Bunn working the other camera. The director today has been Rich Lockridge, still is Rick Lockridge. Jeff Tyndall is on the audio, and Bob McMahon is running the graphics machine. And the production assistant is Tom Brent. And thanks to their assistance, along with the Central Bucks Business Sports team, we've been able to bring you some games. Daryl Garner is the player who is now coming to his senses, and they're trying to help him up. Hopefully he's going to be all right. He's built low to the ground. He shouldn't be too badly off.
Daryl is walking off under his own power, Frank, and we're delighted to see that. And we wish him only the best. We're back in here and play before this one's over. If he's done for the day, he'll have other days. And here comes back to action, 5:58, 6-0 the Bucks. Football at the 21, a wall the up back. Motion Bernhard to the lower part of your screen. Paulus on the toss to Sparango, looking for the block, a wall. Sparango behind an excellent block by Mark Gatto coming across, and Gatto cut down Steve Clark, the fill man, and he gets down to about the 17-yard line. It's going to be a fourth down and two, and this may be the primordial play of this football game, Frank. This is the essence of it.
And again, they're going to go with the refrigerator backfield, put Jeff Cott someplace in the backfield, and Clark Paulus is calling the play, and watch Jeff Cott. He'll probably be your key.
Let's see as they break the huddle. Sure enough, Cott is in the backfield. Paulus to Wall, behind the block of Cott. Wall spinning and driving, and Wall with a great effort, Frank. I think he got it.
Second effort got it for him, I believe.
Yes, sir. Wall delivered. Wall delivered. Dagan, that ball is marked tightly, but Frank, I think the ball's nose is on the line.
Tommy Fingleton's in pain. No, I'm sorry. That's not Tommy. I hate to put that on him.
Mark Gatto.
Mark Gatto, who's playing a great game.
Jeff Japsen says this is a first down, and Frank, from the angle, the chain was short of the 15. That is on the east side of the west side of the 15. The ball is on the east side of the 15, the offensive side, and that should be a first and 10. But credit Chris Wall with some great hard running, and it is a first down as Wall with second effort did it, and Fingleton comes out of the ball game. Frank,
I mean Gatto, Mark Gatto came out. He has some kind of a leg injury. First down and 10 on about the 15-yard line, Marv.
They break the huddle as the refrigerator cut. Paulus calling signals. Paulus hands it off to Wall. Wall slipped. There was a hole, Frank, but not a big one. Clark had it read. Kilkenny had it read. And big Mike Radigan in the middle was the man who jammed it. But Chris Wall slipped. He gets nothing. It's second and 10 at the 15-yard line. 4:37 to play. You can be sure, no question about it, that this is cracks in here.
This is why coaches get paid a lot of money. You know there's some potential ulcers being bred right now on the sidelines for the coaches, because it's second down and 10 on the 15 again, Marv.
Balance line, power eye. They give it to Wall. He follows a block on a great play. Stunting in was 68, Dick Beck. Dick Beck stunted from the backside into the play.
He was just able to get his hand out and trip him up on the ankle. And as you said, on a day like today, that's all you need is a little bit to throw you off balance. And it's going to be a passing situation probably inside the 20.
Football is at the 12, is at the 13-yard line. 13, 3:55 to play. And this is the third quarter. West 6 and East nothing. And East comes out power eye again. Paulus with the ball, faking. Paulus looking. Paulus is being pressured. He throws the football, and it is almost intercepted. It is almost intercepted as Billy Clark had his hands on the football. Paulus was trying, I think, to hit Jeff Japsen, who was behind the secondary, but didn't launch the ball far enough. Had he floated the ball, it might have been there.
Well, as you said, Clark and Caparo converged on the ball, knocked it out of each other's hands, or it would have been an interception. And that's a really tough play because six more inches on that ball, and you're throwing to Japsen, and you got to throw the ball in that situation right there. It's either that or...
Yeah, he's got to give that an extra launch. But who can criticize anybody today, Frank, because the footing is terrible. He gets pressure from the backside by West. The West defensive line makes things happen. Force him to throw it maybe a step sooner than he wants to.
He had a lot of pressure on him, and he did a good job just getting it off close to his target.
That's the movement and counter movement, Frank, which makes this game, this masterpiece of the interplay of the players what it is. Now, Frank, the football is down there in the mud, and while we have timeout, let's get down to Norm Stanley. Now,
Frank and Marv, I was just over on the west side checking on Daryl Gardner, number 40, who was injured on that last play. The doctor there told me that he had been knocked unconscious, but that he is all right now, and he's sitting up, and they're watching him closely, but I doubt very seriously whether he'll be back into the game. Beside me, I have the East doctor, Dr. Mahana, who was with the East Patriots all season long. And I guess we got to go back to the game. Maybe we can get to the doctor later on. Back to you.
Frank, it's fourth down. It's fourth and eight. The ball at the 13-yard line. Split backs, Bernhard and Wall behind Paulus. Paulus back to throw, has some pressure, fires the football. There's a man open in the end zone. Oh, very close, Frank. The ball actually got over Billy Clark's hands, and Sparango had the shot at the football, and it just slipped away from him. That could have been a touchdown.
He put it about the only place he could put it, and it was out of bounds regardless. Had he caught it or not, it would have been a super catch, but he probably would have come down out of bounds. It was an exciting play up here, and unfortunately for East, they couldn't get it in.
Frank Sparango should have no bad feelings. He has been a tough kid all day. He's caught passes. He's run well. And that was a great defensive stand by the Bucks.
But it was a poor defensive series. A great stand finally, but it was a 4-minute and 20-second drive by the Patriots, and that's something you don't see often against the Bucks.
3:40 to play, so this is the first play of the third quarter, and Kilkenny hammers straight ahead behind Power. Gatto is there for East, and at the bottom of the pile, once again, Steve Schilt, the defensive tackle, who's played very, very well all day long for East today.
I have to credit Kilkenny, Caparo, and Radigan right there for that play. I mean, they just laid a block on the whole side of the defensive line right there. Easy work for the ball carrier.
So Kilkenny driving, his legs turning, hammers the football from the 13-yard line up to the 20-yard line, 7 yards, second and three. Give it off this time inside. Woo! Jeff Cott is there. Cott and Knorr fired in and delivered mighty blows and stopped that in its tracks, Frank. No gain. It'll bring up a third down. In fact, a loss of about a half a yard. And I'd say, Frank, it's third and a long three or a short four in a big play if East can hold here.
That's right.
But the Bucks have been trying, Frank, with that drive, which ate up that. They've had two plays, and this is the third quarter. And that's something Mike Pettine doesn't like very much. He likes to get these. That's great offensive striking capacity.
He's counting on this first down.
Here is the very big play for the Patriots and the Bucks. It's a keeper by Clark. Clark reverses his field. They're trying to chase him down. He has running room, breaking down. Good tackle, and he is dropped. He is dropped, Frank. He has the first down.
With a late hit.
He has the first down. A super play by Steve Clark, Frank. As he came back, he was caught in the backfield, reversed his field, wheeled back to this side. Patterson came up, made a good deliberate tackle, did not want him to get out. And, Frank, we got a 15-yard late hit penalty here.
Well, you know, you think you get the guy bottled up, and all of a sudden he breaks out to the other side, which is a play only a superb athlete could make. And it is just that. It's frustration and no bad remarks to East right there. They were just trying to put the hit on him good and clean, and it came a split second too late.
Patterson, I think, made a very wise play making that open field tackle, sure, because if you go for the gamble, he may already have the first down. He breaks it up further. There's a big, big break for the Bucks on the late hit. Gives them field position. Let's see what happens now. They look like they're in gear on the draw. Waiting for it was Gatto, and he drops none of it in the backfield.
With the flag down, Marv.
Didn't see it, Frank. Where is it?
It's the line judge, I believe, threw it. So it is against CB West.
That's a holding penalty. That could be big.
But with that touchdown run by Donovan, that's the previous play was the biggest play of the game by Clark right there. If not, it's fourth down. They got a punt, and East has field position. Instead, it's going to be a first down with a 15-yarder tacked onto it.
Now we'll see what this penalty is. They're talking to Captain Japshin of East, and he has played superbly all day and inspiredly, as has this East team and the Bucks at this point with a drive on. They get a penalty, Frank, procedure penalty against the Bucks of 5 yards. And so the football is moved now to the 37-yard line of the Bucks, 2:10 remaining in this, the third quarter, and plenty of football left in this one. Plenty of it as the Bucks offense is Steve Clark's brilliant play. Trapped, spinning loose and getting out and getting the first down. A great individual effort. Clark the credit.
Unbalanced.
Adjustment. Clark back to roll. Has some pressure. Throws the football. Long and deep. Man wide open. He catches it. Drew Wolf all alone as he got in behind Robbie Cronin. And Drew Wolf has the football at the 32. And the first pass that they throw all day is complete for big yardage to the 32-yard line. And the big thing about it was that Clark has twice made great plays. The individual play for the
right
first down. And then the rollout on the pass. Brilliant play by Clark. Wolf very sure.
Poor Robbie Cronin, he had the guy covered. When Rob Cronin turned to look back for the ball a split second after Wolf did, it came over his head as he was turning around to look at it, and Wolf caught it for a first down.
31-yard line of East, the Bucks are on the roll. They toss to Donovan, he's tripped in the backfield.
Great and play by Jeff Japshin.
Japshin absolutely stood Kilkenny's block and came by and knocked down the tailback Donovan, and the loss on the play of a yard moves the football back from the 31 to the 32, maybe a yard and a half.
A good coaching point in that, Marv, is he took that block on with his inside shoulder, kept his outside arm free, enabled him to make that tackle.
And also, Frankie had excellent foot movement. He had that inside foot lowered into
Kilkenny. That's right. That's exactly right. Inside foot up, outside arm free.
Mike Pettin says, and the Bucks say, take a timeout. And Frank, with that timeout, once again, we want to thank the people who have all year long sponsored this football for us, and they are, Frank, and I'd like to let everybody remember, if you go in to see these people, let them know you like sports on Home-Vue. It doesn't hurt us to be back again, and it doesn't hurt them to think that their efforts are appreciated. Doylestown Federal Savings and Loan, put it away and let it grow. Kingsbury Realtors, one of the great, real, true sports fans, a man who honors both East and West in all sports, and a great guy and a superb organization. Shawnee and High Point, a social high point. Newbolds, Carl Heber Machine Shop, where precision, Frank, is the best bet. Newbolds again, Frank, where your growth and the attention to your stock and your money is primate. McCroskey Music, the sound of good things. Barb Lynn Carpets, they can cover anything you have with quality. Landis & Son Carpentry, for the job that's too big for others. Smith Marine, when you want to sail smoothly. Mountain Lake Patio and Pool and Patio, just the best in the business in what they sell. Richards Restaurants 1 and 2 for great seafood and dining. And Delaware Valley College, Frank, one of the great fine institutions that we're all credited to have and privileged to have in this area. And we're thankful to them and for the courtesies extended to us today. And now second down at the 32-yard line. Clark is going to roll. Clark is being met and dropped as he gets about 2 yards. And Frank, again, Eric Knorr, Steve Schilt, and Teddy Dennis moving in
Teddy
to make
Dennis.
That hit.
Teddy Dennis had a really nice play right there. He came up, took the lead block on, stood up the blocker, and was able to slide off to the inside to make the tackle. Great play by Teddy Dennis.
There's an equipment timeout here, Frank, because Kilkenny has something. There's something that has broken down. The official has called timeout. It's third down and about 9 yards to go for West, and the ball marks at the 30 with 47 seconds to play in the third quarter and a 6-0 Buck lead.
I'll tell you what happened to Kilkenny. Teddy Dennis hit him so hard he popped the buttons off his chin strap and he had to go get a new one.
That is the Frank Case button popper.
That's right. He gets a button popper award.
Frank, there's so many fine seniors on both teams this year. It's not going to really ever be the same when these two classes graduate, because they have brought tremendous glory and quality football to both schools. And I think nobody has any reason not to be very, very proud of the seniors. Not that the other players haven't done well, too, but particularly this senior class of both schools has been an exceptional, exceptional group of young men. Okay, Frank. Third down, here we go. Clark calls it. Clark gonna pass, Frank. He's dropping. He's throwing under pressure. And it is intercepted by Tommy Dennis. Tommy Dennis, the linebacker. Frank, the real pressure there came from Eric Knorr, who blew in again. Eric Knorr, time after time today, has been responsible for tremendous pressure. Knorr came off the backside. Clark threw it into the coverage, and East has intercepted. But it is 16 seconds to go in the third quarter. The football will be turned over to East at the 27-yard line. And I still say, Frank, the problem is much what you said at the beginning. When you get a day like today, it may almost be kind of an underlying way unfair to both teams to have to not give their full armory in this game. And Frank, the clock is winding down, and that's the end of the third quarter. Six for the Bucks, nothing for the Patriots, as you see the two teams get ready to exchange the ends of the field, and the football will be into its fourth and final quarter of this fine football game as East and West meet again in the classic rivalry. And now, standing next to Norm Stanley down below us, is probably the only Princetonian, Frank, that we'll talk to. Probably the only guy with his feet on the ground that ever went there, Dr. Vince Mehta.
I'm here with Dr. Mehta during the quarter change. Dr. Mehta has been with the East Patriots, as we said before. Doctor, during this kind of weather with the ground so slippery, is there any unusual risk of injury for these young fellas?
I think with this particular kind of field, that you're better off as far as the field being soft, less injuries, and the kids can't really hit that hard because they can't really get good footing. The major disadvantage would be that they get a lot of leg cramps. It's hard to run in the mud. It really tries their legs, and I think subsequently we'll see a lot of leg cramps.
Well, thanks for stopping by. We appreciate it, Doctor. Thank you. Back to Marvin and Frank.
Well, Frank, while we were at General Hospital, Chris Wall, behind a crunching block by Japsen and an excellent block by Gatto, churned out an 8-yard pickup and moves the football to the 35-yard line, where it'll be second down and 2 for the Patriots at their own 35 as we start the final quarter of play, 6-0 the Bucks. Power eye formation. Up back is Bernhard, the deep back is Wall. 20 is Sparingo on the wing. They give it off to Wall. Tries to follow a block, but he's hit, Frank, as he gets in the line of scrimmage on just an excellent defensive play for the Bucks. And the guy who makes the play for Central Bucks West is Chris Groves, and he's made a couple of them today, Frank, that have been excellent. Chris has played excellent football today.
He sure has. And the thing that East has going for it right now, as you said earlier, your offenses aren't as efficient in this kind of weather. Therefore, they're not going to score as many points, obviously. So you need less turnovers, less breaks to win the game. They got two breaks right now. They didn't get any points out of it, but they got a turnover just now. Now maybe all they needed, they obviously need one touchdown. They could get it here.
Driving forward is Wall, Frank. It's close, but I don't think he has it.
Looks close.
I don't think he has it, Frank. They're going to mark that ball. It's going to be very well. They're going to have to measure. Wall.
I think it's going to be another big fourth down play. I don't think they have much of a choice. Marv, what do you think?
I'm going to bring those sticks in, Frank. Well, it's a tough coaching decision. 10:55 to play. The ball about the 38-yard line on a horrendously muddy field. They've run quarterback.
Right.
They run quarterback sneak twice, Frank. I wonder what Coach Frank Kristiniak of Penridge, who's probably the master of short yardage dangerous plays, would say. What would Frank Kristiniak say about this?
Well, what, they made the first down.
Frank, what do you think they ought to do right now? What would you call if you were coaching East?
If I was coaching East, I'd give the ball to Wall and just let him run.
Okay, let's see. Frank Kristiniak here with us in the wet and rain. They give it off inside, and he doesn't get it. He doesn't get it. He's breaking through, making a great play with Steve Clark. Frank, while I was moving this microphone out to Frank Kristiniak, I lost complete construction of the football game. I thought we had this great fourth down play.
No.
But Frank, you've got this play working now. You said give the ball to Wall and let him run the rest of the day.
Yeah, I just think he's an excellent back, and he can take it.
Okay, second and 10. Unbalanced again, Frank. Toss to the unbalanced side. Sparingo has running room, picks a hole, and gets it up for about 5. Picking his way across the 40-yard line. Frank, we're always happy to have the fine Penridge coach, Frank Kristiniak, aboard for us.
There's a nice block by Jeff Bernhard was all I was going to say. Marv, thanks to Frank Kristiniak for the insight.
Frank, a third down now and 7 with a football at the 43, and Bernhard has played very well today. And Frank, I certainly would like to just make a special hats off to the great play of Steve Clark offensively and defensively. He's been a ton of goodness for Joyce Petten's husband. Paulus back to throw. Paulus launches the football deep, and it is broken up on an excellent play by Baggett, as Kilkenny and Baggett had good coverage there, and Baggett went up and batted it away, intended for Fahey.
That's the exact same play they had the PI before on, Mark. And unfortunately, Paulus was not able to see number 20, Bart Springer, went out into motion, and he was open for a short gain. If he had been able to throw there, there would have been a first down anyways.
Well, they got a fourth down. They're going to have to boot it. And, Frank, this is Teddy Frisch, number 88 of the Bucs, is into the football game. Junior defensive end getting ready to boot it away, and the snap has to be good. There it's not, but they're not coming. And he gets it away. A long kick to Donovan. Donovan fields it at the 28. He's headed for the right. Donovan looking across. He's being pursued. He gets a cut in the mud. He's on his feet and he's tripped up. And the guy who nailed him was Cronin. Cronin came in with good punt coverage as Donovan made his mind up to break it back into the lane he saw. And he moves to the 40. And it's first and 10 for the Bucs on another wonderful run by Dynamite Donovan.
Well, I think it's really been a different ball game. It seems like West, not only did they score 6 points in the first half, but they won the game statistically. Here in the second half, East is winning the game statistically, but they just can't put together a end zone drive, and that's what they need. They need to stop them here again in the fourth quarter and take over.
They got Fahey at defensive end. They got Jeff Japshin at linebackers. They're resting up and rotating. They give it to Kilkenny, and Kilkenny moving straight ahead on good power is met in there. In the middle of that mud ball, 68 Bobby D'Ortone of East, and again, Steve Schilt filling along with Tommy Dennis. Tommy Dennis making another good play at linebacker, and he's played very well today, Frank. The number of kids who have just played their hearts out today should not be underestimated. So the big co-captain Kilkenny with 8, 22, 21, and 20. 6-0 the Bucs. Football at the 43-yard line. Second and we'll call it 8. Donovan and Kilkenny. On the wing is Baggett. See whether Clark keeps it himself. Toss to Donovan. Running. And he is hit. And down he goes as he gets just up to the 45-yard line on the far side.
It was the Dennis brothers, if I'm not mistaken. I know one of them was in there, and that was...
Well, there's Teddy and Tommy.
Yeah, we'll call it that. But also Fahey and Tommy were in there. Fahey was in there also.
Mike Fahey playing that defensive end as they move Jeff Japshin, the linebacker, to give him Bernhardt a little rest, giving Gatto a rest.
Now, this is a big play for the Bucs right now. There's 8 minutes left, Marv, and it's third down. And in order for East to get the ball back with enough time, they need to stop him now.
Ball at the 45-yard line. 5 or 6, really 6 yards to get. Clark on the quarterback draw, and he fights forward, but he doesn't get it, Frank. He'll be short, and now Mike Pettin has a coaching decision. Is Bob D'Ortone from the middle guard, Mike Fahey, and once again, Eric Knorr assisting on that play, and they stop it. It's a yard short. It's a yard short, and I wouldn't be surprised to see Mike take a shot at it, but I think, Frank, his better strategy is kick him down into the hole. Here come Cut and Gatto into the game, Frank.
Well, he is going to go for it. Drew Wolf runs the play in, and they're going to go for it on fourth down from the 49-yard line. If they make it, they'll be in East territory. If they don't, East will be in West territory.
Well, let's see what we got. They put Cut in the game in the middle. They got a yard. They're looking for him to jam it. Mike's able to take it outside. Long count. Clark's changing up. They shift. East does not go offsides. And they're going to take too much time, and that's what they were looking to do, Frank. They were looking to sucker East into going offside with that long count and that shift. Mike never intended to gamble, and they didn't get it as East, well-disciplined, failed to go offside. And at 6:35 to play, they'll move it back 5 yards to the 44-yard line. 6:35 remaining.
Well, that will attest to the coaching of East right there. That's something you notice in previous scouting games, and they did. They knew Wes was going to do that. And you know John Capel was saying, freeze play, don't move. That's what happened. Good coaching tactics all the way around.
Walt Wandahl will kick this when he takes his steps from the 35. The deep men are 20 Sparingo and 5 Price. As East coming, they are. Good snap from center. And he gets it away. He gets it away, taken by Sparingo. He's at the 30, and down he goes at the 32-yard line. Wandahl wants to get a kick back, but there was no contact. The official's 10 feet away from him and clearly can see it. So the football belongs to the Bucs, to the Patriots rather, as they've held the Bucs again. And with the exception of the long pass, Frank, which was well done by Clark, who really laid it on the money to Wolf, the West offense in the second half has been superbly contained.
That's right.
But now the West defense, which has not yet been scored upon today, and they've been excellent when they've had to be, bend but don't break, they look it over. Eye formation, Paulus to Wall. Wall getting to the outside. Wall with some room to run. Breaks it up and gets about five. Chris Wall cuts across the 35 and we'll mark it at the 36-yard line. We're going to give him 5 yards on that play.
Great cut by Wall right there. So happens so often is everybody gets banged up inside and he just cut to the outside for about a 6 yard gain on first down. Now it's second and three or four.
Second and four as they break the huddle and this is it for East, I think, Frank. 5:30. If they don't do it now, it's done for them.
I can feel the excitement building, Marv.
Paulus to Wall into the middle, has some room and comes just to the 40. He'll be a yard short of the first down. Football will be at the 40. It'll be third down as we're going to reach the 5 minute mark of this football game, and there's still 60 yards of ground, which West will defend as tenaciously as anything they've defended all year. This is as close as they've been this year, Frank. I think it's the first time we haven't been bored watching
our
Bucks.
That's exactly right.
So the Patriots on the 40-yard line on a big third down play for them. Let's see what kind of defense. West jams its linebackers up inside. Boy, they're packed in. Let's see. 2, 4, 6, 7. They got seven. They got almost 8 men up on the line of scrimmage. Kilkenny is almost on the line of scrimmage. Let's see. And Jeff Cott launches offside. And Frank, just as we talked about the great discipline that they showed, Jeff Cott, unfortunately, who's played so well today, played just a super game today, charged offside. Frank attempting to get downfield, and that moves it from third and one to third and six, and that's a big field position change, and it's going to force East to go to an open-up play here that I don't think Coach Kalpin wanted to do just now.
Well, from my vantage point, one play I've seen work for him was when they go down the middle, they put Sparango in motion to the outside. Maybe they'll go with that one because it worked for him almost.
They got Joey Moores and Chris Wall on the wing. Paulus back to throw. Paulus throws, has a man open, 33 Wall. He breaks a tackle, breaks another tackle, and he has the first down as Chris Wall made a great cut, and Paulus put it right in his hands where he could do it. Paulus threw it superbly, and Wall cracks it up to the 47-yard line, and with 4:41 to go, with the pressure on him, they've been able to throw on West all day, and Paulus has done an excellent job.
You said it, he made a great cut right there. He got the ball pivoted and ran inside for the first down.
Chris Wall on a gutsy move off a good pass, and Wall opening up now. They give it to Wall, has some running room, and Kilkenny closes the hole after only a yard. Bill Kilkenny, the fine co-captain, that excellent player, closes it up at the 50-yard line, and it'll be second and nine, and the clock continues to tick down, Frank. It'll be approaching the four-minute mark, and the clock is clearly the enemy of East at this point because they must score. And West simply has to hold ground. They can trade 2-3 yards for time steadily.
That's right.
Let's see what happens now. Five-man front, Orthodox 52. Kilkenny blitzes. They give it to Wall. He cuts at the inside hole, filling beautifully. For the Bucks was Mike Caparo. And he made that tackle after only short yardage just across the 50-yard line. Move it to the call at the 48. Third down and six, Frank. Third and six for the Patriots at the 48-yard line. You know that they will not punt this football at this point. They're going to give it two cracks.
Which is why they can use this situation right here. They don't have to get the first down on this play. They have two downs to work with.
Brian Price on the wing. Motion away, Jeff Bernhardt. Toss, give it off to Sparango. Has a block, and he almost broke it, Frank. Has an excellent block from Bernhardt, the up back. Popped him across the 45-yard line.
Mike Caparo reached out and tripped him up, Marv.
Yeah, I think Caparo tripped him, and he almost had that footing. That mud hurt him, too. But the ball now, Frank, this is the big one of the ball game. Let's see where they mark it. They mark it at the 45. It's fourth down, and 2 yards to go. 2:50 on the clock. 6-0 Bucks. The Patriots don't make it now. I think it's sayonara. Jepson in the tight end. I formation, very muddy section of the field. Bernhardt comes in motion, and offside jumps Jepson. Once again, the Patriots are hit with a critical penalty as Jeff Jepson anticipated the call and flew offside. And Frank, they were coming toss sweep to the wide side. They were going to pull the guard and come toss sweep. So now instead of fourth down and 2 yards to go, the second breakdown, they got away with the first one. The second breakdown now puts them into a tough situation where they are at the 49-yard line and West takes a timeout. With 2:38 to play, the Bucks take timeout, and Mike Pettine says there's 8 yards here. That's all we have to defend. They can wrap this game up. I don't think East can get the ball back again, barring a big break. And at this point, Frank,
if you take a key look at this, Petten has to be in the huddle telling them, hey, every possibility on pass coverage, they've got to throw the ball.
He's just telling them to not give him too much cushion. A defender will give a cushion to the wide receiver of anywhere from 8 to 12 yards. And here, you want it to be less than 8 yards so you can get to him before he gets a first down. And he's also yelling at his defensive lineman, too, to give him a rush. Because those two things, good secondary coverage and good pass rush, are going to determine the fate of this play right here. Defensively for East, for West. For East, conversely, you know, Kaplan's telling his line to block and giving specific instructions to his receivers.
Frank, 2:38 to play, and if you take a careful look at this football game, it's amazing the amount of time of possession in this, the second half.
I know. As I said, East has clearly won the second half of the ball game. Statistically, point-wise, it all amounts to nothing, but it all comes down to this play right here, 4th and 8.
Frank, Mike Petten has made an interesting change. He's put a clean jersey in there, 42, Randy Cuthbert. And Randy Cuthbert, through the year, has been better and better at pass defense every ball game, and that shows you what Mike's expecting. He's going to put a fresh man with fresh legs, not so much mud, not so much weight. Let's see what the Patriots offer. Brian Price is wide to this side. Japshin, the tight end. Wall on the flank. Single setback is Bernhardt. On the wing is Sparango. Paulus throws the football, and it is... Oh! It should have been intercepted by Clark. It slipped off his hands, and it fell to word number 20, Sparango. Clark did a great job of coverage, and even if Sparango had caught it, Sparango would not have had the first down. So with 2:33 in this football game and a 6-0 lead, the Bucs, undefeated and ranked first, have held off another thrust by the crosstown rival, the East Patriots, who have played a great second half. And at this point, Frank, the Bucs only have to eat down, I'd say, about a minute and a half to 2 minutes on this clock. And that they're very capable of doing because they have good field position.
Well, I think some of the fans agree with you because they seem to be heading out. But I disagree. I think it's going to go all the way down to the end of the game, and I'm staying till the end.
Well, Frank, we've never left one so far. But this has been a heck of a football game, and there's plenty of credit for both football teams. Plenty of credit to be distributed all around. All right, let's see now. Will the Bucks go with power with Kilkenny? They've opened up with a big hitter with him early. They give it to Kilkenny. He bangs forward, breaks one tackle, gets a couple of yards, picks up maybe 2 or 3 yards.
But more importantly, keeps the clock running with 2:20 left.
Yeah, the clock is ticking away, Frank. Every tick of that clock is another dagger in the heart of East. 6-0 the Bucks. They deliberately, patiently excise that clock. 2nd and 8. Football. 49 of East. East packing it up, Frank. They got 8 in there with the linebackers blitzing. Clark's going to roll. They're coming up hard to support. Clark breaks a tackle, and Clark has the first down, Frank. I think Clark has it. As they caught the end, pinching down on the inside, and Clark made a great shifting move to juke the back coming up to support.
Right, they caught the defensive lineman pinching on the inside. Matt Baggett was able to kick the corner out and then open up a nice lane. It's going to be real close to the first down.
I think this one, Frank, at 1:45 of the clock stopped just for the purpose of measurement. This one now belongs to the Bucks. But this has been a great football game, played in absolutely horrible conditions. It's a first down for the Bucs as Steve Clark, who all day long, I think, Frank, if he had to single out one guy who at critical moments in this game has made critical plays and
right.
has been brilliant, Steve Clark gets that medal. Remember that keeper, Frank, where he was locked in? Could have changed that. That could have made the 30 yards difference on that last drive.
Along with the touchdown, I call that the most important play of the game.
Donovan's super run, picking his lanes behind Beck's big block. But otherwise, the East team has been able to silence West. They're jumping around back there. 1st and 10. Clark again on the quarterback draw, but moving through to nail him. From the backside was Dortone, the middle guard, as he digested that. And he stopped him for just the very shortest of gains in the middle of the mud. And East calls timeout, Frank. 1:17 to play. This the fourth quarter of this football game. West 6 and East nothing. 6-0. Football resting at the 40-yard line of East. second and 10. But there will be undoubtedly that West will run three plays here. They will not turn the ball back with the Reno kicks. They'll run it and force East to use every timeout. Wonder how many timeouts East has left. Two?
I don't know, Marv.
I don't remember them calling a timeout. You know, up till now. 117, 6-0, football on the 40 of East. Second and 10 to go for the Bucks. On what has been a cold and wet and dreary and drizzly day, but
weak.
It's been a good football game, Frank.
It's been that kind of a whole week.
Bucks break the huddle with a full house tee. Fullback Kilkenny trying to bounce it to the outside, but they've jammed it again. And at the bottom of the pile for the Patriots is number 68, Bobby D'Ortone, who's played well, helped by Mark Gatto, and big Jeff Cott would not be moved as he jammed the play. The ball continues to tick. It's third down, and the ball's at the 39-yard line. Third at the 39, the clock is running down. East may be saving this. This will be their last timeout, and they'll be down to about 30 seconds. Clark calling the signals. All he has to do is fall on the ball, Frank. They don't have to chance a fumble. Clark keeps it, and he's dumped in the backfield, as blowing through to get him was Tommy Dennis. From the defensive end position, now East takes its timeout, and they force a fourth down play. And now Mike Pettine has his choice with 33 seconds remaining, and I think his choice will be not to kick the football, risk the block punt. I think he'll just eat this time up by having a safe kick. He'll tell that kicker, if there's any kind of bad snap at all, fall on the ball. Get it away only if you see it clear. Tell Walt Wandell, or they'll just run the play. Because the football's at the 41-yard line of East.
I wouldn't be surprised.
East is running a kicking team in, Frank, on your monitor, and you see John Calpin down below talking to Don Harm. He's trying to bring together his offensive, his group, I think, to get him ready to go as soon as this whistle blows. Seconds remain in this football game. It is fourth down and 12 yards to go for West.
I would look to see West throw the ball downfield. I don't know if I'm totally off base, but if you throw the ball downfield, three things are going to happen. It's going to be incomplete, you're going to catch it, or they're going to intercept it, and if they intercept it, it's like a punt. So I'd like to see that happen. I think that might be a good move.
I think, Frank, that the problem is that I don't think what Mike Pettine fears is some mishandling of the ball in the air and a back running loose in the open field.
That's true.
Because on the pass, they're going to have to stay in and pass block, or a fumble as the kid drops back from pressure. If Wandell isn't in the ball game, Frank, they may come quarterback draw or roll out. They're going to do something just to keep them in bounds and run some time off. Fourth and 12. East with their secondary practically up on the line of scrimmage. It is the rollout, and that will not go anywhere as being brought down is Steve Clark, and sandwiching the play, number 68 again, Bobby D'Ortone, who came through courageously, and number 54, Eric Knorr. And Knorr has been there time and time again today. And Frank, there's 28 seconds to play in this football game. East has recovered the football at the 45-yard line, their own 45. They're 55 yards from the goal line, and West is dropping their secondary back. They'll give them anything short.
That's right, and they got three or four plays over here right now. Right now, they're just going to go with the rainbow Hail Mary over here to this side.
Wouldn't be surprised if West picks it off. Yeah, they got three men spread wide to this side, Frank. West with four men up front coming. It's a missed block, Frank. A missed block on this side. It's an incomplete pass.
We don't know who that is, but he sure is happy.
I'll tell you who it was, Frank. It's number 85 of the Bucks. That's Paul Shish. The young defensive end, as he slid off the block of Bernhard and went inside and put pressure, and Paulus never had a chance to put it up. It cost him 6 seconds. Paulus's arm coming forward, however, saved a bigger disaster. Shish just blew in.
See, now they're going to wind the ball. They should be on the ball right now, I think.
No, it's an incomplete pass, Frank.
Oh, I see. I thought it was a fumble.
Maybe he's asking for a new ball
referee,
or a towel.
Yeah, referee's time. He wants to make sure that he's got as good a ball as possible.
I think the officials have done a super job in this game, Frank. I think it's one of the best officiated Bucksmont games, maybe one of the last Bucksmont games ever to be played.
That's right.
The Bucks may have won the last Bucksmont championship with the events that have been taking place.
And I think rightfully so. I believe that there's become too big of a gap between the upper and lower echelons in the league.
Courageous fans, Frank, down below us in rain gear, who said, hey, we're not leaving until this one's over.
Well, they got at least two or three more chances to throw the ball downfield.
Fahey comes to the sideline. Do they have 11 men out there? They do. Price is on the wide side. Paulus back to throw. He's rushed. He's looking to throw screen. He's going to go down. He's going to go down, Frank.
Dick Beck shut the door.
Dick Beck through. Paulus had no chance. They were trying to throw a quick screen to this side, a wide screen, Frank, to the three receivers. They're going to downfield. 7, 6, 5. Frank, you hear the crowd counting it off. Paulus may or may not get it off. This is it, Frank. Paulus fires the football, and it is intercepted at the end by Kilkenny, but it'll mean nothing. The game is over. The Central Bucks West Bucks have conquered the Patriots of Central Bucks East with a 6-0 win. And I tell you, Frank, there is glory for both teams here. Neither team, as you see the jubilation and the disappointment, neither team here should feel in its own mind that they are the superb conqueror of the other, because both teams went at it today.
They sure did.
And this whole community can be proud of what these two football teams have done all year. And in this particular football game, hats off to the undefeated Bucks. We had the pleasure of being with them the whole year. But principally and formidably, Frank, we want to salute both teams, because John Calpin in his second season had a great year at East, and these kids came on at the end of the season
right.
And did well. And there is the traditional handshake, Frank.
East really rose to the occasion, Marvin. I think it's really appropriate for CB West that the last two plays of the game were accentuated by two of the primary forces for West. Of course, the sack being by Dick Beck, and finally the interception to end the game by Bill Kilkenny. And it was really appropriate because those guys, along with Donovan and some of the other players, were the forefront and vanguard for CB this year.
Well, there was some exciting plays, Frank, and some great individual players today. Steve Clark of Central Bucks West, time and time again, responding both offensively and defensively. Jeff Cott of Central Bucks East, who played brilliantly today, offensively and defensively. Eric Knorr.
Dortone played a great game.
Bobby Dortone, the middle guard. Dick Beck, time and time again, his crushing block to open the way for Donovan. For Donovan's 39-yard touchdown run, which remains their only score, as you see the coaches shaking hands with each other, the tremendous camaraderie, the friendship, and the spirit of the best of high school football as we take a break. Norm Stanley, and with him, one of the great gentlemen in the game of football, one of the fine teachers and fine coaches who's establishing a reputation as a principally excellent guy, John Calpin.
I'm here with Coach Calpin, the coach of the Patriots. Coach, an awfully wet day, but your team hung in there real well, and it was an awfully well-played game, I thought, for a muddy field on a day like this. 6-0, you certainly, you and your team certainly has nothing to be ashamed of. They did a good job out there.
Well, obviously I'm very pleased with our team. Our kids really played their hearts out, and it's a shame that we were just one play short, but I give West a lot of credit, but I'm very proud of our football team today.
Well, I think you should be, and I really appreciate you stopping by and saying hello to us. Thank you, Coach. Back to you, Marvin, Frank.
Well, it shows, I think, some of the caliber of the men, the John Calpins and the Mike Pettins, who both teach and coach in this system. I mean, it suggests to us always that the men who have been associated with athletics in the Central Bucks West school system have been responsive not only to their kids, but to the highest quality and highest calling of coaching as a profession and of teaching as a profession. And I think that some of us tend on occasions to forget the tremendous time consumption and involvement that these men put in to produce this kind of team. This just doesn't happen by magic. And it's not just what the kids put in, it's the men who lead them. And we have the best led two football programs, Frank, in eastern Pennsylvania. There are other programs that function superbly, but there are not two programs in one community, Frank, which have the stuff that these two programs do. And I suggest probably that we ought to be very, very grateful in those times when we're forgetful for men like this.
Well, John Calipin, of course, lost the game and is very disappointed about that. But aside from this final loss, he can look back on this season and with a sense of accomplishment and pride in what he and his team has done. He can take this offseason and really relax because he deserves a vacation. He earned it, and their team played well and with heart all season long. CB West, on the other hand, gets a few days to really celebrate before their kids slide into another program. And I just want to give my personal thanks to Home-Vue and CB West and East and Del Valle for allowing us to come into their programs and for the viewers to come into their living rooms and broadcast the games for them.
And Frank, it's been another nice year doing it with you. I hope we'll both be in good health and back again next year to do it together. And I think the winter season's coming on us strong. There's a big program of basketball and wrestling and swimming and both men's and women's basketball that we're going to have for you with a whole bevy of people bringing those things your way, and we're looking forward to that. I think probably, Frank, the thing that we'll miss the most today is the opportunity. No, we're not. Here it is. They brought him over, the ancient, 11-0, the winner, and the coach of the first place football team in the state of Pennsylvania, His Honor Mike Pettin.
I'm here with Coach Pettin, the coach of the victorious Bucks today. Coach, congratulations on an awfully outstanding season and a really tough win today in this weather. I'm sure you're proud of your boys.
If you just wanted the winning coach out here, I didn't think I was going to be here. East played inspired football. It was a great football game. I think our guys were a little flat. However, when everything was on the line, and I think our people reflected on what we've done and what a loss would have meant to us, it would have taken a lot away from what we have done. I thought you saw us rise to the occasion.
Well, I saw that, and especially there in the last quarter when there was East drive or two. The Bucks hang in there very well, and they brought out a win, 6-0. It's a win.
It was a tough game to figure what to call. We probably should have opened it up more, but it was just a situation. Like, even in the second half, I second-guessed myself. We elected to kick off. It was our turn to receive. They take the ball instead of getting them in the hole, which we thought would have good field position. They drive down and put us in a hole. So we earned every inch of turf out there today. I think we really had not been tested. And I don't think, I guess the season is fitting unless people get a little scared, and I think they'll feel a lot better about it, winning close and realize that it could have been the other way. Maybe they'll enjoy some of these lopsided ones a little bit more.
Well, again, Coach Pettin, thanks for coming out here. Congratulations. It's been an awfully fine season.
Right.
I know that that you were rated in the top 25. I think it was number 15, 16 in the USA Today,
right.
Top in the state. You've got to be awfully proud of this team overall.
Yes. When what we said all along, we couldn't enjoy it unless we were there at the end. Now, hopefully, we'll still be there. Before leaving, I want to, again, congratulate the East kids and their coaches on an outstanding effort. And those people who didn't show because of the weather missed one heck of a football game.
Well, they certainly did. It's awfully cold. But again, congratulations, and thank you for stopping.
Okay.
Back to you, Marv and Frank.
Norm, we're privileged to work with you today because your on-field interviews are excellent. And we want to thank Mike Pettin, who has been a heck of a guy all year long. And Frank, we've been the kind of the voice of the Bucks this year because of the circumstance. And I think Mike's going to...
No, stay down there.
Mike was going to come up here, but we want to thank Mike for letting us be the voice of the Bucks this year. Frank, it's very nice to have been part of football in the Bucksmont. And as most of the fans know, the Bucksmont League right now is at the crossroads. A number of teams have dropped out of both the Bucksmont and the Chessmont. What it will be next year, what we don't know. We're looking forward, however, to one thing, that both of these teams will return a number of excellent football players. And I think that there's no reason to believe that the caliber under coaches such as Pettine and Kalpin, the caliber of football will decline at all just because of the change in the league. These two programs
right.
are solid base.
That's right.
And I think, Frank, that the only thing we can say is we close it out on a cold and wet and rainy day here today, which belongs to the Bucks 6-0, is that this is the best of high school football, and the people of this Doylestown community, the entire general area from which kids go to East and West, they ought to be very, very proud because they got the bragging rights anywhere they go. Frank Case, thank you for putting up with me all year, big guy. I know you want to be out there rolling around that mud today. This was your kind of game. We loved it, and we'll be back next year. So long to the sports audience, the football fans of the Bucksmont, and remember, it's still the game.